Alright, so my final talk this CakeFest is about scaling Cake PHP. The talk is probably going to be more about what scalability is and the generic problems you encounter while scaling your application rather than being Cake PHP specific. There will be some tips and tricks there, but in general, Cake PHP got very little to do with actually making a scalable application in the first place. So let's start. What is scalability? Scalability is many things. It's a multiple faceted problem. One thing is speed. Speed is not directly correlated to being scalable, but it obviously helps being fast, so you can handle more requests per second. Scalability can also be that you can scale out by having many servers, like scaling from one web server to 100 web servers using Amazon or whatever service provider you prefer for that. You can have fewer servers, but scale them up by having larger servers. So if your data set grows in your MySQL database, you just go from a 16-gigabyte database to a 64-gigabyte database server and just scale that way instead of rather than replicating the data out. Most projects in terms of scaling up and scaling out usually have a mix of those two. You probably scale up your database and scale out your web servers and caches. PHP, by default, scales very well. It's stateless by definition, so usually when your application suddenly doesn't scale, it means you've done something wrong. It's not Cake's fault, it's not PHP's fault, it's usually us as developers that do something wrong. So scalability is also capacity planning. You would like to have a predictable path that you need to scale. So you know, okay, if our traffic go up 30%, that will cost this amount of money, and it will require this amount of extra capacity. And lastly, scalability is also about automation. You want to be able to scale up and down automatically, and you would like to be able to not spend weeks and weeks managing 200 PHP servers by hand, but actually have an automated infrastructure using Chef or Puppet or whatever software there is. The first thing I'm going to show is a very, very scalable PHP application. It's not very fast, but it's very, very scalable. And why it's scalable is because it's stateless. There's absolutely nothing going on here. It's slow, but that's not a requirement to be scalable. You know in this case that, well, if your server can handle 100 requests per second, and another server can handle 200 requests per second. That's basically it. It's scalable by definition. There's no network, and it's very, very cacheable. You can put Vanish in front of this, and you're done. It's nice. Sure, we just improved the speed a bit. It's now twice as fast. But it doesn't change the scalability properties of the application. It's still scalable. It's just faster. So you can, by improving speed, you just make it more scalable. You just reduce the amount of servers and capacity you actually need to serve the application. And I think that's a very important distinction to have, that speed does not equal scalability. It's two very, very different things. This application could sleep 20 seconds and it would still be very scalable. An example of something that's hard to scale is this one. Now you have a session and you have something stored in that session and suddenly you have a state. This cannot very easily be cached because it's unique for each user. Each user would have something between 1 and 8 seconds sleep. And it's unpredictable. You have no idea how much capacity you need to serve this app, because if you're really unlucky, all the requests take 8 seconds and not 1 second. So it's very, very hard to scale it because it's random. So as I said, scaling Cake PHP got very, very little to do with Cake PHP in its own, but very much with everything else like servers, databases, caching, PHP in particular. The best Cake PHP tip I can give is Debug Zero. It is very, very easy, it's very, very fast, and you get caching. Everything else from here is not specific to Cake PHP. Sure, there is, like, you can change the caching, you can change the session handler and all that, but that's not related to Cake PHP directly. Any framework can change those things. Most important thing about Debug Zero is you have to do it in your core PHP. If you do it later, some files may already be included, some caches may be loaded with a low timeout, and the caching is not as effective as it could have been. So don't change it in your controller, change it in core PHP. So, as I said, scalability got a lot to do with architecture. Anything can scale if you have the right architecture as a foundation of your application. So the architecture would be different layers. The web server is one layer that's very obvious when you talk about scalability. There's PHP as another layer. Web server and PHP do not need to be on the same servers, depending on what requirements you have. There's a caching layer, the database layer, which I forgot here, and the storage layer. Those layers, if you can separate them out nicely from each other, then you have different layers you can scale independently of each other. Each layer produces its own different problems when scaling. Usually disk I/O can very, very fast kill your application's performance. Network I/O, usually from file servers. I mean, you can probably have like 100 web servers and 2 file servers for redundancy, but suddenly the network I/O from those 100 web servers hammering the file server just fills up the pipe from the network, so you start waiting on the network rather than serving requests. And of course, then suddenly it doesn't scale very well. The CPU is also a very obvious thing that can produce problems. Both database and PHP in particular is very CPU hungry if you do it wrong and right. And there is kernel limits. At some point when you keep tweaking your application over and over and over, at some point it will be so fast that the Linux kernel will start acting up. An example of that is a server I did at Nodes. I was tweaking Varnish, I was load testing, we had 15 PHP servers in the backend, and I reached around 2,500 requests per second, and then suddenly all requests started dropping. The reason for that was that the Linux kernel on the Varnish servers decided that it was under a denial of service attack instead. So that was not good. So it started like, okay, I'm not going to handle anything from this IP that I did the load test from because it is doing a denial of service attack on me instead. So I had to go in and tweak the kernel a bit and tell it like, relax, relax, it's okay, it's not a denial of service attack, we are just very busy. And then it scaled continuously back again. So some general tips for scaling. These rules are like super strict, but of course you cannot live up to all these rules without exceptions. If you really want a scalable application, you should never touch a file system. That's easy to some extent for PHP. You can have an up cache that reads the file once and you're done. You should avoid the network, so if you have a service-oriented architecture, you should do that as little as possible. A network also includes stuff like going to the database, going to a caching servers, going to file servers, logging, all that stuff. If it hits the network, it will by default be slow compared to just not doing it or just doing it locally. Caching, obviously, is a no-brainer. The more you can cache, the less your servers have to handle, and thereby free up resources to do things faster. Even more important, use a fast cache. There's plenty of ways to cache things in a slow manner. A good example of that is CakePHP's default caching engine, File Engine, which violates the first rule of no disk. Defer everything you can. So like a welcome email, do not send that in from Apache or Nginx or whatever. You do that as a background job, as shown in the workshop. There's absolutely no reason why the user should be punished by having a third-party email provider being slow or your local postfix server being slow or backed up for some reason, or even being down and you just have 30 seconds timeout on that, and the user just hangs. Use the right tool for the right job. For example, don't do full-text search in MySQL. Use Elasticsearch for that. It's much faster to it. And it's way faster and easier to scale that way compared to MySQL. Kill slow requests is a very important thing. Keep your timeouts from external services very, very low. It's easier to just kill people being slow than having them hog up the connections or free connections on your servers. And a very popular example of that is when people want to do a denial of service attack against GitHub or whatever. What they usually do is they have a script that opens a connection to GitHub and very, very slowly, like every 10 seconds, just send a byte and say, I'm still here, I'm still reading the data, I'm just very, very slow at it. And suddenly when you have 10,000 of those, all your Nginx processes are busy sending these very slow requests and regular users cannot access your website. So low timeouts is super important, especially on network, which is by definition very unreliable. As I said earlier, as Vanish, ensure that the kernel is ready for a busy life. The default kernel in both Debian and Ubuntu can to some extent handle most of the load, but once you start really having a busy website, the kernel needs a lot of tweaking. That goes both for network buffers, it goes for disk caches, it goes for a tons of stuff. I have like 80 lines in, I have to change in the kernel to make a server run optimized. Those are in my repository at GitHub, yibi/vagrant. All my performance optimizations are in those Puppet manifests, if you want to check them out. And most importantly, perhaps most, but a nice trick, is to do manual configuration. And what I mean by manual is that do not rely on the software you're using to do auto-scaling. An example of that is Apache, which like in prefog mode says, oh, don't worry about it, you just tell me how few servers I should run and how many I can run and I will take care of it. Don't do that. Hard code both of them and say to Apache, listen, you're going to consume this amount of resources and that's it. The benefit of that is if you suddenly have a slow traffic day for like months and you suddenly start to scale and your Apache processes get more busy, then as Apache starts starting services up to handle more and more requests, suddenly your server runs out of memory because you never really tested how it handles 80 Apache processes instead of those 5 it runs as minimum. PHP pro tips, use an opcache/apc. Opcache is new in 5.5. Previous for that, you should use apc. Settings that are very relevant to apc if you really want to make things fast is a setting called apcstat.0. What that does is it tells apc to read the PHP files and never ask the file system if those files are changed again. So that means basically every time you deploy, to tell PHP that the files have changed, you need to reload FPM or Apache or whatever to flush those caches. And the benefit of that is that you can have a web server that basically don't have any disk activity because everything is run from memory. Other things you can do is to have a in APC have write log equals 0 as well, which means that APC will never log a file for reading in case a file is not cached. It will just read it and do it. The downside to that is if 5 requests hit the same file, it will be cached 5 times in a race condition. But that's fine, because the 6 requests and going forward will hit the cached version. And the benefit is those other 5 requests will not wait for the first request to cache it, so you get a more immediate response from that. Sessions, use Memcached or Redis. They are fast, really, really fast. Going from just using local database, you can use file, whatever. My experience is that you can get 10 to 15% performance increase just by changing to one of the in-memory session handlers. Cake is bundled with both Memcached and Redis. Another unknown trick is use a Pickle extension called IG Binary. What IG Binary does is it's a better serializer for PHP resources like an array or whatever. It uses less memory inside the in-memory storage, and it's much faster to deserialize and serialize it, which means that in your application you save a lot of time reading and writing sessions or view caching or whatever you're doing because it's a more optimized serializer. Xdebug, don't use it in production, seriously. It fucks up your server. It's very, very slow, and it does a lot of instrumentation against your PHP installation, which means that even though you don't expect to use debug, it will still instrument it by default. Don't even load it. The less modules you load in your PHP installation, the less memory consumption you have, and the less instrumentation PHP needs to do to execute your application. Logs, never log those to file. If you have to log them to syslog, and let syslog forward them to a central syslogging service. You should not log them directly yourself to a network because that goes against the no network rule. Defer the logging to another service that pipes it to the network. Syslog is very, very good at both buffering and shipping logs over the network. You should not try to do that at home. PHP FPM. Do not use more workers than you have CPU cores. The reason for that is if your site suddenly gets very, very busy, then if you have 8 cores and you have 32 workers, then suddenly all those FPM workers have to fight for the same CPU resources, And the end result will be that all the web requests will be slower the more requests you have. So what you want is to have very, very fast requests and let the rest of them queue up rather than saturate your server completely. Use one FPM pool per site. It's a kind of no-brainer as well. Each FPM pool will have its own memory, which means that if you deploy one side, it will not flush the caches from the other sides. Isolation is king when it comes to stuff like that. And again, as I mentioned before, hard code the number of workers inside FPM as well. FPM has a very nice feature called dynamic amount of workers, set it to static and hard code it to the number of CPU cores. The web server, use whatever web server that works for you. Chances are that the web server will not be the bottleneck of your application anyway. If you have a web server with 8 cores, you will have 8 FPM processes, and you will have Apache or Nginx in front. Apache and Nginx are roughly equally fast at serving FPM requests, and static files, you should never have those on your web servers anyway. That should be served from a CDN. So use whatever you're comfortable with, and that have the configuration and flexibility you need. At Nodes, we use Apache, and I could easily get like 5,000 requests per second out of 15 web servers. And that was without any fancy buzzwords or anything like that. It was just Apache, standard installation, change the amount of workers, and that was it. No other configuration change was done there. And again, hard code the amount of Apache workers. Do not let Apache try to be smart about how to handle its workers. You know how many requests your server can handle because you, of course, tested it. Database. 5.6. Use MySQL 5.6. And if you're really fancy, use Pecona's MySQL 5.6. It has a serious amount of performance optimizations, including, but not excluding everything, subqueries. Subqueries are insanely fast in 5.6. They have optimized it, so it's near instant. Some of the examples I've seen is like easily 80% speed improvement just by upgrading. Also, 5.6 features a lot of new interesting features that can help you make your application faster by deferring requests, use caching warmers, and stuff like that. I will get into that later. Use InnoDB. InnoDB is transactional. It's very, very fast. And since 5.6, it also features full text if you insist on doing it in MySQL. You no longer need to use MyISAM to get full text search within your database tables. Another very important feature about InnoDB is when you do replication, you should have those InnoDB replication logs on a separate file system than the data file system. And the reason for that is that the disk that serves your data in the database should not be busy writing and reading transactional logs to other slaves. Keep those things separate. Memory for any database is a no-brainer. You should have as much memory as possible. Ideally, you should have enough memory to keep your entire dataset plus indexes in memory. But of course, as once you start going across a few hundred gigabytes, that's going to be impossible. So what you do to minimize that impact of not having everything in memory is to use indices. You index your columns. Make sure all your queries use indexes and do not use any kind of file sorting or heap tables or anything like that. That's very, very important. Profile your SQL queries. Chances are your PHP, no matter what you do, will be very, very fast. But those SQL queries you just hack away at will probably be like 80% of the request time anyway in the long run, once your data size grows. If you have a read-intensive application, replicate your MySQL servers. Add some read slaves to your master server and make your application use those. Do as little as possible in the master once you get to a replication. Basically only do writes there and let all the slaves handle the reads. Partition your data. You can do data partition in many ways in MySQL, but by far the easiest way is to use the table partitioning, which basically means that you tell MySQL that within some data range, they should go to different files on the file system. If you do that very, very fancy, you can actually tell MySQL, hey, every data for the last quarter should go to this file on the file system that happens to be a SSD hardware RAID. But all data before that should go to the slow disk, because I don't really care about it. It's just for people who browse archives. So suddenly you can have some very, very fast disk access for all the new data if it's needed, and all the old data you can just put it into some slow disk and don't care about them. Node joins, also a no-brainer. If you suddenly need a lot of data partitioning, the less joins you do, the less work MySQL have to do. And by definition, the less MySQL have to do, the faster I can do it. Use cache warmers. Once you start having a big replication ring of MySQL servers and you bring up new slaves, make sure that they are warm. You should never bring in a MySQL server to your setup that is not pre-warmed. And what I mean by that is you should replay select statements that are the most popular on your website, so those are in memory already. So when that MySQL slave joins the replication ring, it's already pre-warmed, so any website hits that goes to it will not have to wait for MySQL to read that from disk and actually be able to serve it to you. Fast disk, as I mentioned, as fast as possible, because at some point you will hit the disk. So use SSD if possible, or at least some good enterprise hard drives. Track your performance. That's by far the most important thing. Use a service like New Relic, which is already being covered here yesterday, I think. And keep testing. Scalability and scaling your application is never anything where you can say, like, okay, I'm done. We can scale now. It's no problem. It's a continuous effort. And chances are that if you suddenly say, okay, our site can handle 2,000 requests per second, it's super awesome. Then some developer go like, okay, I'm just going to add this feature, and suddenly you cannot scale at all because that feature introduced something that's not scalable. So keep monitoring your performance. New Relic is very, very good at that. It can pinpoint which service layer that is slow if you use it correctly. And just realize that it's a continuous effort. And that was basically my scalability tips and tricks. Any questions? Yeah.
The joins in a normalized database.
Yeah.
How do you avoid doing joins when you are trying to keep as little redundancy as possible?
You can't. What you can do is, depending on the characteristics of your data, you could denormalize it in Elasticsearch and read it from there instead. That would mean that you just read one record from Elasticsearch and that's it, no joins. You can do like 10 joins, normalize it, and dump it into another data store. You could also just cache it inside your application. So you do the expensive query and then cache it for a good while. But of course, at some point, when you stop doing joins, you will have to duplicate the data. There's no way around that. But usually what I would prefer was simply to start dumping that data into a data store that's more efficient for unstructured data, like a denormalized data would be. Yeah?
I think you mentioned with the modules on production, did you say that that I should have the minimum amount of PHP modules and modules for any service on production? So like I have IMAP running on production for my PHP, but I never use it. Does that affect the performance of the?
Performance, no, but it'll have effect of your memory consumption because that module and all its dependencies will be loaded into memory when PHP starts. And of course, you want to use as least memory as possible because that can be used for other interesting things like more aggressive caching and whatnot. So it's very important to keep all installations as lean as possible. Don't include anything you actually don't use. And the same goes for MySQL. MySQL in some installations come bundled with like 5 or 6 different table engines. Just disable those you don't need. Just only say, I want InnoDB. Any other questions? Yeah?
If you're using Amazon RDS, can you just assume that they're doing most of the database optimizations you talked about?
The memory optimizations by changing how much caching MySQL can use is done by RDS, and they're pretty good at it. So when you upgrade your database, it will automatically change the key buffers, caching, and stuff like that for you. They actually read-only, so you cannot mess with those settings. A little trick to RDS specifically is when you need a database server, create one with 10 gigabytes of data, and then keep increasing the database by 10 gigabytes until you get what you actually want. Because every time you do that, internally RDS adds a striped amount of disk array to your web server, to your database server, which means you have different zones to store your data, which again means you have more disk I/O capacity. Other questions? Yeah?
How do you choose between APC, Xcache, Memcache, or Redis?
You test it. That's basically the only thing I can say. Everything you do, don't assume anything. Do not always believe tests you read on blogs. Do not believe me. Test it. That's the only thing you could do, because my data here could be wrong. I just presented what I've learned while scaling my application, but your application may be very different from what I do. And therefore, another caching engine could be very much better for you than APC or Upcache or whatever. Any other questions? I don't have my glasses on, so I can't see anything. Nope. All right. Thank you.